Just pray with me tonight. Father.
Father.
Give me living revelation.
Give me living revelation.
Help me to be a burning lamp.
Help me to be a burning lamp.
In my generation.
In my generation.
Thank you that the darker it gets.
Thank you that the darker it gets.
The brighter our light will become.
The brighter our light will become.
In the name of Yeshua.
In the name of Yeshua.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. No cowards here tonight. Amen.
Yeah.
You know, cowards don't inherit the kingdom of heaven. That's what John wrote in Revelation.
That's right.
The cowardly don't get in. But John the Baptist wrote that the kingdom of heaven is forcefully advancing. Ooh, hallelujah. Yeah. And we are forcefully advancing it tonight. You know, sometimes we have nice days like we have today, of which I just thank God for another peaceful day in our city and thankful for just the shalom that we've had in our day today. But sometimes we get so caught up in our little world, our four no more, that we don't look beyond the small picture into the bigger thing of what's going on. So sometimes it's just kind of good to get a cup of water in the face. Have you ever had anybody throw cold water in your face? So I'm gonna throw just a little bit of cold water in your face tonight. I feel like Alex Jones. I've got my headlines laying here in front of me. But I'm just gonna read just a few this afternoon. I just got on the internet literally and just thought, I just wonder if I could pull off a few headlines. And literally within 30 minutes, it was amazing of what is going on in the world in comparison with what the Bible says is going to be the increase of birth pains into the birthing of the new reign of Messiah on the earth. Hallelujah.
Lord.
But here's one from theendbegins.com. The headline says, outrage as Obama in Germany calls for borderless globalization of all Europe. And just a sample underneath it says, Obama is working overtime to force through his globalist trade pact, the TTIP, because there is the main tool that will effectively erase Europe's borders. And then it says the one world government is being assembled at a very rapid rate, but it will depend heavily on who is the next American president. And I pray that you're praying over the presidential election. I don't know how to pray, so I am praying in the Holy Spirit, our secret weapon. Amen. But please be praying. Please be praying because it makes a difference. Here's another headline. Pope Francis abandons Christian Syrian refugees and takes only Muslims to the Vatican instead. Again, theendbegins.com by Jeffrey Gritter. And it says, Pope Francis, in a gesture of compassion, decided to take 12 Syrian refugees to the Vatican to live behind this big wall where he tells everybody else to take his wall down. But when it was discovered that two of the Syrian refugees were actually Christians and not Muslims, they were dropped like a hot potato and told they could not come, even though the Vatican had promised to take them. The alleged story is that their paperwork was not in order, but it was a brother and sister who were Christian refugees and the Pope would not take them.
Wow.
And I prayed for them tonight. I pray that you will pray for our family that is being persecuted.
Yeah. Yes.
There were like two, I don't have all my numbers correct, but there was like 200 million Christians that used to live in Iraq. And the genocide that has been going on there is just incredible. And it's our family. When Mark was preaching on Sabbath about the accuser of our brethren, that word, I've always said the accuser of the brethren. And I've realized I've been misquoting that verse my entire life.
Come on.
It's the accuser of our brethren.
That's right.
And I know James has a t-shirt that says my family is being persecuted. And we just need to get some of those. Because I'm telling you, we need to pray because it's our family. This is in our nation. ESPN, you guys know that one? Fires Kurt Schilling Schilling for saying that transgender men should not be in the girls' bathroom. They fired him for that. Again, Jeffrey Gritter for theendbegins.com. I don't even have to read that excerpt from that. I think the headline from that is self-explanatory. Along that same line, this was from Alex Jones' InfoWars site. It says, believing in two genders is a hate crime under police investigation at a Catholic college. There was a Catholic faculty that expressed her opinion based on traditional Catholic doctrine and that was actually asked by some kids hanging up a poster. They misrepresented the case, and now they're calling it a hate crime. And that's this going on there in that situation. This is happening. I mean, we go about our little day and our little things, but I'm telling you, sometimes we need some cold water thrown in our face to realize there's more than our little macrocosm going on in the universe, right? Or microcosm, thank you, I'm around that there. Here's another one. I wish I had the ability to show you guys the drone footage of this, but apocalyptic drone footage shows giant cracks in the earth on Japan's southern island. This is by Michael Snyder from his website, from his blog, and I'll just read this first paragraph. It says, the drone footage is jaw-dropping that went over southern Japan, one of the islands. When I first watched it, I could hardly believe the extent of devastation that was taking place on Japan's southern island. Near the end of last week, a magnitude 6.5 earthquake was quickly followed by a magnitude 7.3 earthquake in just 28 hours. And then he goes on to say, those earthquakes made headlines all over the globe, but at first glance, those numbers don't really look that big. So why was there such tremendous damage? Well, it turns out that those two major quakes worked in conjunction with more than 600 small quakes. And I believe that was in a 7-day window. And literally, when you go to the site and you play the footage of the drone flying over, it's just that he just goes for miles, or it goes for miles and miles and miles, and just shows the crack in the earth there. And they're fearing that it's going to literally split. I mean, this is incredible stuff that's happening. Bob Jones had some prophecy about when you see the second big quake hit Japan, watch out for California before he passed. I'm telling you, we need to be prayerful in these days, not fearful. Everybody say, not fearful.
Not fearful.
Yeshua said, I'm telling you this ahead of time, so when you see this stuff, you won't freak out.
Right.
And you'll know that your redemption, which actually in the Hebrew root means separation, is drawing nigh.
Right.
But we need to be aware of what's going. We need to have dialogue with people as we go about our days, as we go through our city, with family, with friends. And we need to wake up and let the light of Messiah shine upon us. Oh, sleepers, help us. There's sleeper cells in the church, but help us. Okay. All right, here's another one. The shaking continues. The most dangerous volcano in Mexico has erupted in spectacular fashion. Can anybody say the name of that thing down there? More than 25 million people live in the vicinity of Mount Popocatépetl. Is that close? I just don't speak Aztec. But including Mexico City's 18 million residents. 18 million. 25 million people are in the vicinity of this thing, and it's popping its cork. At 2:32 local time on Tuesday morning, this past week, the most dangerous volcano in Mexico roared to life in spectacular fashion. As this is, many experts extremely concerned about what is coming next. A full-blown eruption of Mount that could be a cataclysmic, unlike anything that modern Mexico has ever experienced before. And considering what has been happening in Ecuador, you know that one, Japan, we just talked about, and at Yellowstone. If you don't know what's going on in Yellowstone, it's very interesting. The roads are melting. They've taken down their whole reporting system. A reporter on YouTube called one of the head guys there and says, why is your reporting system down? Because everybody is freaking out. And he said, it's okay, we're just updating our system. We do this every once in a while, which is true. But the interesting thing is, when it came back online, this shows the seismic activity in Yellowstone, it's time delayed now. So you just wonder, you know, did they do that on purpose so they could control something? Because the ring of fire is so active, and the earthquake and the stuff that's happening. And if you're at all familiar with the prophet Neville Johnson from New Zealand, the Lord has actually taken him down into Yellowstone and showed him the plume there. And Sadhu has also had a prophetic word about Yellowstone blowing in this nation. And in an encounter that I had and what I saw in the future in this region, there was ash over everything. And I didn't see Yellowstone go, but it would make sense that that's what was covering everything. Now again, We're not to be fearful because God has already given us and the remnant of God all over the world a prophetic word that in this place, He is establishing a place of refuge. Right. There are small pockets of believers all over the world that are returning to their Hebraic scriptural roots, growing in their identity of God, that are believing and God is speaking to them about places of safety and refuge, being in the future. And we've got some things that God has told us to store up, but it's not about storing up and building bigger barns. Can I hear an amen?
Amen. Yeah.
Because if you hoard, you're going to lose it. It's about having what you have, giving what you have, and as we give, God is going to multiply that
right.
and see others met. And there's going to be a mighty harvest
amen.
That's going to come in before the Lord's return. Did you know that the CIA, since 2005, has been moving their major headquarters in this nation from the East Coast to Denver? And this is Washington Post reporting it. It's just like there's a lot of people asking, why are you moving your headquarters, you know, to an area where FEMA is establishing rescue camps all down the Ohio Valley. FEMA is establishing rescue camps. Mark was called to go to a chaplain area where they were preparing for the New Madrid Fault to go off. Many people in this very assembly has had dreams and visions of the refugees coming this way. But everybody say, do not fear.
Do not fear.
God told us in advance that this stuff was going to happen, and He is telling us how to be prepared for the day that we're living in.
Right.
And here's two that's more on topic with what we're going to speak on tonight. Astronomers skeptical over Planet X claims. It says two controversial new studies suggest the discovery of large objects at the outer reach of the solar system. This was published in December of last year on scientificamerican.com. And there's these two guys, and I'm not going to read the article to you, but they have found two objects in the sky, in an area of space, rather, that has not been identified before. And they printed these results and uploaded it on a place on the internet where scientists can go and get research, and other researchers are coming in and taking part of that and speculating, could this be the region where Planet X, which is not like some obscure little tinfoil hat group of people, but mainstream astronomers are looking actively for Planet X. In fact, the Vatican has a place on Mount Graham in Oklahoma with an infrared telescope, an observatory looking for Planet X. This is happening in the planet that we live on. Here's another one from physics.org. Researcher links mass extinctions to Planet X. This was put out last month, 2016. I'll read just a little bit of this to you. Periodic mass extinctions on Earth. Have you ever noticed that? You ever seen those in your Bible? Sodom and Gomorrah, Noah's flood. There's some stuff that's happened back there, okay? Periodic mass extinctions on Earth, as indicated in the global fossil record, could be linked to a suspected ninth planet, according to research published by a faculty member at the University of Arkansas Department of Mathematical Sciences. Daniel Whitmore, a retired professor of astrophysics, now working as a math instructor, published findings in January issue of the monthly notices of the Royal Astronomical Society. James, I think you ought to write a few articles for that. But anyway, says that the as yet undiscovered Planet X triggers comet showers linked to mass extinctions on Earth at intervals of approximately, and his dates are off here, but 27 million years. And the bottom line of this, and while we're talking about this tonight, is this. Whitmire says what's really exciting is the possibility that a distant planet, this is what mainstream scientists believe, that a distant planet may have had a significant influence on the evolution of life on Earth. In other words, we're here because of Planet X and things that may have happened with that. And so that's a segue into what we're talking about tonight. Because believe it or not, the Bible may not be silent on the subject of Planet X. And so we're eventually going to get there. And as I told you, I've been reading a book by Douglas Elwell on Planet X and the Sign of the Son of Man. And again, it's not a book that I chose to read. It's a book the Holy Spirit told me to read. And in doing that, as the Lord does with me many times, it's like a big fat sandwich. So I try to eat a big bite and regurgitate it, pray over it, and then put it through what the Holy Spirit is showing us and present it here. And that's what I'm trying to do tonight. We've been doing this. This is like study sheet 5 on this. But in the introduction and big picture, I feel like tonight, because I've done several just splats where I've just said all this stuff and I haven't written it out, and I thought it would be helpful to just kind of see the big picture of what we're going to be looking at in the next few lessons and then kind of back our way into it. Sometimes I like to just leave a little bunny trail, but I know where I'm going and you don't, so it makes more sense to me. So I thought what I would do is paint the big picture and then we'll kind of back into it. You with me?
All right.
Everybody shout hallelujah so all the sleepyheads will wake up.
Hallelujah.
All right, good job. Letter A. The earliest recorded accounts of creation in our scriptures and in all ancient Eastern civilization creation mythologies, and we've talked about those for the past 3 weeks, of the Sumerian creation accounts, all Middle Eastern creation mythologies that come through the ancient Sumerian creation accounts. Right. And they all involve a conflict, or I would rather say a judgment, of the supreme God, as we know as Jehovah, Lord God. But other religions take this same motif and they insert their own false God. So you have this conflict, judgment, and creation that is a master warrior God and a dragon. Now there are many versions, but in some variation or another, the dragon is defeated and the triumphant God creates our world out of the dragon's defeat. Now when we first read that, we think, well, what does that have to do with our Bibles? But interestingly enough, our scriptures are not silent with dragons. And many times, at least in my Christian education, has been overlooked or sidelined or taught as not important or just, let's just skip this section because it's a little complicated. But in the days to come, how many of you know God is going to be revealing things to us so that we will have greater understanding, as he told Daniel, and be able to shine as stars in our generation?
Right.
Next paragraph. In this study, we are examining this viewpoint in Scripture and then linking how this dragon judgment slash creation will play out in the future in time events. It is impossible to understand prophecy without understanding our history. Mm-hmm. Letter B. We will also explore how the very kingdom Satan ruled over before his rebellion was somehow connected to a planet first occupying our present day asteroid belt. Everybody say wow.
Wow.
That's a wow thought. And we're going to be looking at this in relation to the firmament in Genesis 1. All right? This is crazy stuff. It's out there. I realize that. But I'm just asking you to be a good Berean. Let's take this stuff. Let's go to the scripture and let's see what the Bible has to say about these things. This asteroid belt is possibly the remains, and I say possibly the remains, of the judgment of Satan's pre-Adamic kingdom theorized in science as the impact theory. And if you're a science buff, you've heard of that. The result is that the earth as we know it today, in its current positional orbit as third from the sun, with its satellite moon, I write long sentences like Paul, but anyway, was created by God out of this judgment. So we know, if you believe in the gap theory between Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and in the earth. And then in verse 2, this earth is void, it's formless, it's empty, it's covered with water. What is going on here? And so if you've ever read Dake's annotated Bible or read several people along this line, there is a gap theory of which I prescribe to that between Genesis 1:1 and 1:2, something happened. Because when Satan shows up in the garden, he is already our enemy. Water is never created in Genesis 1. It's pre-existing. So something happens. The earth is not created. The land is called out of the water. It's pre-existing. Now, what we missed is that there's other bodies in, there's other texts in our scripture besides Genesis 1 that speaks of creation. Mm-hmm. And when we look at all of these creation accounts in the wisdom books and in the prophets, and we put them together with Genesis 1, we get an awesome panorama of what may have entailed in this creation account. Why is it important? Because the lie and the deception that may be forthcoming with the revealing of the Antichrist is inherent that we understand our history so that we're not deceived about our future. Okay? So let me pick up with that sentence again. The result is that the Earth as we know it today, in its current positional orbit as third from the sun with its satellite moon, was created by God out of this judgment, the judgment of Satan and his kingdom, and thus known in Scripture as God's footstool. Heaven is my throne. What is God's footstool?
The earth.
The earth. Why? Because it is the location where his enemies are under his feet. Hallelujah. Now you see the little chart here, this little picture on page 2, and I'm sorry I forgot to punch the color page when I made the copies, because it's really pretty with the colors, and we'd get you a color copy if you want it. But if you're like me and it's been a while since you had an astronomy or outer space update, you may need to see here, you've got the sun, then you've got Mercury, Venus, and then there is beautiful Earth with its satellite moon, perfectly situated in our universe to be not too hot, not too cold, have seasons just where Father wanted it, amen?
Right.
And if when we look at this stuff, it's not at all undermining the sovereignty of God or God as creator, but it's actually just putting some understanding with those truths that we uphold, all right? Now, if you notice past Earth, then you have Mars, and then right past Mars, you have the asteroid belt. And that is what we're going to be looking at. Is does the Scripture give us any hints that there may have been, and mathematically it's proven true, a planet there in that region that possibly Satan ruled over at one time and was destroyed? And what we see there are the remnants of that. The Earth and our satellite moon were created out of that. Amazingly, as we go through this, guys, our Bible is not silent on this.
Wow.
And if you've ever done a study or documentary on the rings of Saturn, you know the rings around Saturn are not just light rays, but it's debris. It's a debris field that came from some type of explosion. Have you ever looked at our moon? It's not just some beautiful, smooth surface. It looks like rocky when if they're beat it up. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And so there's been, you know, cataclysmic events that have happened in the universe around us. And I will say again, as we go through this, at least be open-minded to see what the Scripture has to say about it, because it is not silent about that. Now here, we quote Genesis chapter 1, verse 2. It says, and the earth came to be formless, it says in my translation, and empty. Say empty.
Empty.
And darkness. Say darkness.
Darkness.
Those are the two words, bohu and tofu. The same two words are used in Isaiah that says God did not create the world, tohu and bohu. We'll look at that again. We've looked at it in the past. He did not create it empty and darkness, but it became that way. Why? Okay, we're going to be looking again at that. And darkness was on the face of the deep, and the spirit or the wind of Elohim was moving on the face of the waters. In this study, we will continue to examine what the Scriptures tell us of how the earth came to be in this state. Letter C. I must reiterate that a shallow understanding of creation will make us vulnerable to the deception in the last days of this age as the fallen ones continue to deceive the world by rewriting history and taking credit for our origins.
Wow, that's good.
This will be supported with ancient artifacts that have been seeded all over the planet, and lying signs and wonders will accompany them. It is going to be the great deception. But the great truth is going to be shining in the middle of it.
Hallelujah.
And we have a part to play in it.
Amen.
Letter D. We will also be investigating how the current mainstream search by astrologists for Planet X. Now, it's called Planet X because they used to believe Pluto was a planet. It's lost its planetary status, and it's been downgraded.
Oh,
all right, bless Pluto.
But
they call it X, representing the Roman numeral 10. There, but some call it Planet 9. If you go by the Sumerian text, you call it Nibiru. But mainstream basically calls it Planet X. And it may play, now I'm just going to read this again. We will also be investigating how the current mainstream search by astrologists for Planet X may play into, and I prayed and prayed over this word that I used right here today. All right, but this is the best word I could come up with. May play into the instrument that God used for judging Satan and his domain that also resulted in the state of the earth found in Genesis 1:2 that we just read. And we'll get to that as we look. Now, when we talk about a natural instrument that God may use to bring judgment, some people may go, oh, but God's sovereign and he just does things. Well, that's true. He is sovereign and he does things. But he does use natural means to bring about what he desires to have brought about. And that's what the next sentence says. This in no way, please say no way.
No way.
Thank you. This in no way takes away from the creative power of God in the Genesis account itself. Just as God used a natural means such as the flood to judge the fallen ones in Noah's day, he may have very well used a natural means to judge Satan and his kingdom in the pre-Adamic period.
Selah.
Letter E. We will be looking at how Planet X may be again an instrument of God that has, what we just talked about, played a role in other major biblical catastrophes like Noah's flood, and how it may be future tense, a major cause of the effects we see Yeshua give us in the Olivet Discourse, Matthew 24, and Luke, and in other passages in relation to that, concerning the signs of the end of the age and other apocalyptic passages. Now, guys, I have to say, as I have been researching this now for a couple of months, and I'm reading the headlines that I just kind of gave you guys a glance of in just a moment, it is amazing when you go to Scripture and you look at what Yeshua and the prophets said and John, what happened before the return of the Lord. And then you look at what a large body they say that Planet X, from a scientific standpoint, would have 10 times the mass of Earth, be 4 times larger than Earth itself. If you take a body of that size and you put it into the inner solar system, most people say on its circuit it goes through the asteroid belt, and it could be one of its satellite or comets or debris field that would plummet our planet. And when you look at the gravitational effects that are happening right now on the outside of our solar system that scientists are giving heed to, and that's why they're looking for Planet X, but you give that type of gravitational effect and debris field upon the Earth, and you reread the Olivet Discourse and what the prophets say, you have to stand back and go, wow. And when Matthew 24, when Yeshua said, when you see these things happen, look up because the sign of the Son of Man will appear. What is the sign of the Son of Man? And when you have in Revelation 6, the sixth seal, kings, say kings,
kings,
presidents, queens, princes, the top people in the world. Right now, they're building shelters in holes all over the world. It's like the end thing for all the elite to get their little dugout places, and they think they can dig a hole and hide from Yeshua when he returns. But I'm telling you, Peter wrote that in the end, the day star will rise in our heart. Now, I'm still studying out and asking the Holy Spirit, is there a possibility that we're going to look through together in the study that Planet X could be an arm, or as Doug Elwell would say, the chariot of God that he would ride on his circuit to come and bring judgment upon the earth? Or could it possibly be the sign of the Son of Man that has appeared in the past and will appear again, and this time will bring a cataclysmic end and interruption to the Antichrist and his kingdom? The first time, they dig a hole in the earth, but in Revelation 19, the kings, because of the frog spirits sent out from the false prophet, the Antichrist, and the dragon, they pull them together to Armageddon to fight against the Son of Man. What if they're fighting against his return? And what if the space shield they're conducting around our planet right now is to dupe mankind into fighting against the return of Yeshua? Those are some big honking questions. Come on.
Yeah.
But I tell you, we have the Holy Spirit inside of us. And in 1 John, it says that we have an anointing from the Holy
Come
One.
On.
And we can know the truth. And the Holy Spirit is to lead us into all truth. We don't have to be clueless.
That's right.
And so we're going to be pondering in some of these things. And we may just get through the introduction. But look at Luke chapter 21. Again, this is Luke's account of the Olivet Discourse. When asked, what will be the signs of the Lord's return and of your return? And I'm just going to read a few verses here. Luke 21, starting in verse 25. I mean, listen to this in light of what we just talked about. And there shall be signs in the sun and the moon and the stars. There are sunspots going crazy right now. In fact, there's one guy that's correlating the sunspot eruptions that are happening with the earthquakes on the earth, and how when they're having these mass ejections from the sun right now, it's triggering these massive earthquakes. Again, the sun will be affected by a large planetary body that would come into our system.
Right.
Yeshua knew that. He made it. He created it. And he knows what would happen. Again, I'm sorry. It's just, get off text. It's exciting. Verse 25. And there shall be signs in the sun and moon and stars, and on the earth anxiety of nations and bewilderment at the roaring of the seas and agitations. Do you know what would happen to the seas if a large planetary body? What causes our waves in the first place? Partly it's the gravitational pull of the moon. Now, I am no science like geek or really smart scientifically. I've always loved science. But I'm reading and researching, and I know the God who made this planet. And I'm telling you, when you look at that and you read some of these verses, you're like, wow, what else would call the roaring of the seas and the agitation that would cause the nations to freak out? But we won't be freaking out because we'll say, oh yeah, the Holy Spirit had us study this a couple years ago. We know what's going on. Let me get my Bible and I'll show you. People will be amazed and they'll pray to the God of heaven, the creator of heaven and earth. Because he's the revealer of secrets, just like Daniel's God. I'm getting happy. Hallelujah. Verse 26. Men fading. I'm glad it doesn't say women fading because people wouldn't pay attention to that. These are men. Men. All right, this doesn't say women either. Men are going to be fainting. I mean, it takes a big thing. I've never seen my husband faint, you know? But men fainting from fear and the expectation of what is coming on the earth. Think about this. And the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. And then they shall see what? The Son of Adam coming in a cloud with much power and esteem. And we're going to be standing, not quaking at this coming, not quaking at what's coming, not quaking at the roaring of the sea, not quaking at the comets that are falling like figs, Isaiah says, or he says the earth is going to stagger like a drunkard. We're just going to be standing and looking up saying, our redemption's drawing nigh. Hallelujah. The prince of this world is going to be finally judged. Glory to God. Look what Peter had to say about it. And then we'll jump to some Old Testament stuff tonight. But 2 Peter chapter 3, interestingly enough, as a child, I put this passage of scripture to music and used to sit at my piano and play an accompaniment to this little part of scripture. Yes, I was a dramatic child. But 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 10 says, but the day of Jehovah. Now, I just want to stop, and I know we've done a whole teaching on the day of Jehovah. But this generation has a whole orientation from modern prophecy teachers that there's the tribulation and there's the great tribulation. The tribulation, other than what we live in every day, because you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven except by tribulation. That's what God said. We face tribulation every day in one sort or the other. There is the great tribulation, but it's really important in the days ahead. If you're going to avoid deception, to call something what the Bible calls it. And I want to thank God for Mark and his apostolic leadership and our group here to go back to calling things what the Bible calls them, like the baptism in the Holy Spirit, the promise of the Father. Like waiting prayer instead of soaking prayer. Nothing wrong with soaking prayer, but I've had people email us and go, what is soaking prayer? And so when you teach them about waiting on the Lord, they're like, oh, it's no problem. They can get that because it's scriptural. The day of Jehovah. It is all through the prophets. I think Amos was the first one to use the phrase. And it's important to read and understand what the day of Jehovah is. It's Revelation 6 seal. God pops the clutch and here comes the wrath of God. It's the day of Jehovah when the righteous are shielded and when the wicked, those who dwell on the earth, are judged. Okay? So this is what he's talking about here. But the day of Jehovah shall come as a thief in the night. In other words, it's going to be dark, naturally and spiritually. In which the heavens, look at this, shall pass away with a great noise. I don't know about you, but I haven't been walking outside of my neighborhood and the heavens just pass away with a great noise. That is pretty cataclysmic. I'm in verse 10.
Yeah.
2 Peter 3:10, and the heavens shall pass away with a great noise. Some people have been freaking out on YouTube over these shofar sounding currents and stuff that may be coming from CERN, that they're messing with the earth, but they're hearing these large noises coming from the heavens, and they're rushing out with their iPhones and their little cameras and capturing this stuff. We haven't heard anything yet.
Come on. Right.
In which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with intense heat, and the earth and the works that are in it shall be burned up. Look around tonight. Everything you see will burn.
Right.
Trump Tower will burn. The biggest house in this city will burn. Sometimes because God's called us to live a simple life. You know, I'll be driving those satellite cars, and a really pretty, shiny, beautiful, nice new car will pass by. And I'll start looking at it. I'll start, that's nice. Boy, I'd like to have a car like that. You know, the concert's coming up, and then I remember it's all going to burn.
That's right.
Lay up for yourself. Now, is it wrong to have a car like that? No, if God gives it to you, enjoy it and drive it. But don't put your treasure, don't put your heart there. And God's calling us in this place, and we're going to teach more on this in the future, to live the simple life and to invest in the kingdom.
Right.
And not be a materialistic, consumer-oriented American in our generation. I'm telling you, that is miracle power right there.
Right.
Do I own that yet? No. But Holy Spirit is challenging me with that. And I'm loving it because I want to live in the culture of heaven. Ooh,
hallelujah.
Okay, I'm sorry. Here we go. And the earth and the works that are in it shall be burned up. Verse 11. Seeing all these are to be destroyed in this way, what kind of people are you to be in set apart or holy behavior and reverence? We need to be thinking about these things. Nowhere in the Word do you see. Don't think about that. Don't think about the end of the world.
Right.
Don't think about prophecy. No. Don't study that. It's not taught in some mainstream churches today. It's kind of taboo. You don't want to talk about it. It's a downer. People don't want to know. That's
right.
Terrible. They've been duped by the spirit of Antichrist. And they don't realize that when you hear this stuff, it causes the spirit of Jehovah to come upon you.
Oh.
And as Peter, Apostle Peter, that boy that the church, the assembly would be built off of that revelation with, says, when you hear about this, think about it, it causes you to want to live a set-apart, holy life in our generation. And if there has been a generation on this planet, now and to come, where we need to be living set apart, holy and dedicated, or as I like to say, lovingly committed to God, it's in this. And knowing this causes your heart to burn with that. It causes you to know the purpose of our generation, glory to God. Verse 12, looking for, just forget about it. Don't think about Yeshua coming back. Don't understand prophecy. It's too complicated. You're not supposed to know it. Is that what it says? No, it says looking for. And as we look for, I don't understand this, but we hasten it.
Come on.
As we look for the returning of Yeshua, the return of God physically, he's here spiritually, but physically reigning on this planet, it hastens the day. I mean, that's amazing to me.
Come on.
We have a part to play. And I'm telling you, there's not a lot of people crying out for a deliverer right now. But just give us a few more years down the track that we're on. There's going to be some people looking for it.
Right.
And it's going to hasten. Just like God said, I've heard the cry of my people in Egypt.
Right.
And I've sent a deliverer.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Looking for and hastening the coming of the day of Elohim. That means mighty one or God in most translations. Through which the heavens shall be destroyed, being set on fire, and the elements melt with intense heat. But according to his promise, we get really, really busy and do a lot of stuff for God. Is that what it says?
No.
It says, but according to his promise, we what? Wait. What's the job of the last generation on the planet? It's to wait. You look through the prophets over and over and over and over again in the context of the day of Jehovah. Our job is to wait for the deliverance of God. Why? Because what we're entering into is so big. We can't deliver ourselves from
right.
it.
Right.
And our salvation is going to be by the hand of God.
Right.
Our deliverance comes by Him. And we're going to see mighty acts of God in this generation that we have never dreamed of seeing.
Hallelujah.
It's going to be awesome. And we're just going to wait as we read these headlines and as this stuff just keeps like blowing up and going everywhere and it just comes at you and you're just media onslaughted. You just need to look at it and don't get afraid. Don't panic. Just see it and then just wait. God, you're my deliverance. That's why God is developing waiting prayer in this place where we come. And we're not actively trying to do something. We're waiting on Him, our salvation, our hope. Now, out of that comes assignments and things that like Passover that we just had. In His presence here, come on. I'm just amazed. But according to His promise, we wait. We wait for a renewed heaven. God has to do that. And a renewed earth. God has to do that. In which righteousness dwells. People know which bathroom to use when righteousness
dwells. Come on. Amen.
That's right.
Amen. Say that again. Say that again.
I can make a joke, but I'll go. It's really too sad to make a joke.
Right.
So then, beloved ones, looking forward to this, ignoring this, not thinking about it, staying so busy, being afraid because it's complicated. No! Looking forward to this. I mean, did you realize what I just read? The heavens are going to disappear. Everything's going to burn up. The sky's going to catch on fire. And Peter is so assured in the one in whom I have believed and I have committed unto him everything for that day. He said, looking forward to this. Tell somebody tonight, I am looking forward to this.
I'm looking forward to it.
I mean, you may not be there yet, but this is scripture.
I mean, it's going to be awesome.
This is something we're supposed to, as the people of God with a hope and an understanding, look forward to. Because God's going to be seen as God. Satan is going to be seen as Satan. The evil ones are going to be apparent. And John wrote in Revelation, let the wicked be wicked and the righteous be righteous. There's coming a day when that's just all you can say. Looking forward to this.
Come on.
Do your utmost to be found by Him in peace. What are we to be about right now? Spotless and blameless.
Come on.
We need to be letting God deal with our lives.
Come on.
I heard Neville Johnson say the other day that if Yeshua came back right now, it would be a catastrophe. Because we're not spotless and blameless yet. I don't know about you, but I'm not spotless and blameless yet.
Right.
But even in this feast of unleavened bread that we're in right now, after Passover until next Sabbath, you know, and at our house we call it the Don't Eat Poofy Bread Week. You know, as we go through this, it's amazing how many times we're reminded to just keep sin out of our life. And the stuff, and I shared, you know, Sabbath, just honestly with you guys, how God was dealing with some anger in my life. And I thank Him for that.
Yes.
I thank Him that He is dealing with issues that I don't even know or see so that I can be a part of a bride who has made her garments ready for Him when He returns. So what are we supposed to be doing? Everybody say looking forward.
Looking forward.
And letting God deal with your stuff. It's not the time to hide it.
Come on.
It's not the time to put it under the rug. It's not the time to say, oh, it doesn't matter. It does.
Yeah.
And yes, it's going to be a sovereign work of God, but we have to cooperate.
That's good.
To be found by Him in peace, not freaking out. But at peace. I mean, have you ever been in a wild situation and there's a person standing there that's just at peace? People are going to be drawn to that. Because you know the story. You know the players. You know what's happening. Verse 15, and reckon the patience of our master as deliverance. And also our beloved brother Saul wrote to you according to the wisdom given here. And I love Peter getting on Paul here. But it says, and also in his letters, speaking in them concerning these matters in which some are hard to understand. Which those who are untaught and unstable twist to their own destruction. And boy, do they today. You have grace and you can just live any way you want to.
That's right.
Read Romans. Twist to their own destruction as they do also the the other scriptures. Verse 17, you then, beloved ones, being forewarned, watch. Watch, lest you also fall from your own steadfastness, being led away with the delusion of the lawless. Oh, it doesn't matter. If I speak up, I'm liable to be persecuted. I might lose my job at ESPN. You know, I might get a bad reputation. My aunt may not like me. My Uncle Joe may think bad about me. Don't be ashamed of him. And don't be ashamed of his ways, because when he comes back, his reward is with him.
Amen.
Right. Yeah, that's right.
But grow in the favor and knowledge of our Master and Savior, Yeshua Messiah. To him be the esteem both now and to a day that abides. Can I hear a hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
I'm just telling you, those are some verses that are worth meditating on in the days that we are living in. But we're just going to finish up kind of what we got into the other Sabbath, and then we'll go into the rest of the notes next time. But look in your handout, if you have it with you from last Sabbath. It's Study Guide 5, dated 4/16/16. And go to letter G in that handout. And we're looking at an overview of what the Bible says about the rebellion of the dragon in connection with the last days, all right, with our future. Now, it seems like most people are, you know, more acquainted, because the way the Holy Spirit had John write Revelation, that when we talk about the dragon and the end times being defeated, most people are like, yeah, that Satan, the dragon, is going to be defeated. We're comfortable with that. So we're going to start there and look at it, and then we'll finish that out tonight, and then in our next session, we'll begin to look at what the scripture says about the dragon and creation, because the same dragon at the end was the dragon at the beginning.
That's good.
All right? So in letter G, we have this overview. So turn to Isaiah chapter 26. And we read these verses last time. And again, this is a particular verse that was quickened to us on the Feast of Tabernacles, starting this year, 5776 on the Hebrew calendar, that we're in this year. And this is the word that God gave to us. And it's a call to intercede in this time, not to hide, to go in your room and hide, but to be an intercessor for this time and to draw near to the heart of God. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Isaiah 26, yes. Verse 20. Go, my people. I mean, that's like, you don't have an option here. Enter your rooms and shut your doors behind you. Reminds me of Matthew 6, shutting yourself away, yeah, in a secret place, praying in secret. God will reward you openly. Hide yourself, as it were, for a little while. Everybody say, until.
Until.
The displeasure, it's the displeasure of God, is past. For look, Jehovah is coming out of his place to punish the inhabitants of the earth for their crookedness. And the earth shall disclose her blood and no longer cover her killed ones. Now, chapter 27 and verse 1. In that day, say that day.
That day.
Again, this is called by Bible scholars Isaiah's little apocalypse, these few chapters here, and it's about the day of Jehovah. It's about this end time that we're coming in. And in that day, Jehovah, with his severe sword, notice he has an instrument. He has a tool here that he uses. In that day, Jehovah, with his severe sword, great and strong, punishes who? Leviathan, the fleeing serpent. Leviathan, that twisted serpent, and he shall kill, say kill, the monster that is in the sea. Now, the casual Bible reader reading through the Bible in their year plan comes across this verse and is like, whoa, wait a minute. What is this Leviathan thing lurking here? I'm just reading about God's wrath. He's coming and all of a sudden he's wrestling a sea monster. What is going on? All right? So we're going to establish Leviathan, the word, how it came to be, and some more stuff. But I just want you to be acquainted. This is Isaiah writing about the future. In the future, Jehovah is going to use an instrument called a sword, and a strong, great sword. He's going to punish Leviathan. He's not just going to punish him. He is finally going to kill him. Can I hear a hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
All right? So we see the end here of this. Now turn to Revelation chapter 12. And here the Apostle John is riding on the Isle of Killings. That's what Patmos means. Woohoo! He's on the Isle of Killings writing this for us. But Revelation chapter 12, and we talked about this, it's in your notes. We went over this in our last session, but let's just read for context, verses 1 through 3. And a great sign was seen in the heaven, a woman clad with the sun and the moon under her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars. And being pregnant, she cried out in labor and in pain, gave birth. And we looked at the constellations and how that alignment is actually coming up next year, 2017. Verse 3, and another sign was seen in the heavens, and see a great fiery dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns. So here we have the Apostle John introducing to us this character of a dragon. And Mark actually preached on it on Sabbath. That is going to be our adversary at the end. Now turn over to page 7 and let's look at letter K. And that's basically where we left off last time. Page 7, letter K. These are other end time scriptures concerning the dragon. So we have this one in Revelation where Jehovah is taking out his great sword and piercing this fleeing serpent. We have John here writing about this dragon in the last day. In verse 9, we have this verse. And the great dragon was thrown out, that serpent of old. So this links the serpent at the end to the serpent at the beginning.
Come on.
And the great dragon was thrown out, the serpent of old, called the devil and Satan, who leads the whole world astray. Now, for those watching on YouTube, if you watch the series on the coming alien deception, you'll hear a teaching on the word astray used in the Greek, which is planea in the Greek, and it means, we get our English word planet from it. And it's just interesting that every time in the Olivet Discourse, when Yeshua said, do not be led astray, that word astray is always linked to planets. And it's like he was pointing towards something for us, okay? Mm-hmm. And you can hear that and listen to that for yourself. But notice here, the great dragon, the serpent of old, the devil, and Satan. And in the end, what's he trying to do? Lead one nation astray? No, the whole world. This is a master plan that he has been planning for ages. But it's doomed to what? Thank you very much. Revelation chapter 13, verse 1, next scripture. And I stood on the sand of the sea. This is the next chapter. And I saw a beast coming up out of the sea. Now notice here you have a beast and you have a sea. It's real important to see that this sea creature is Leviathan. And it's always related to the sea. And it's related to the dragon. Now this beast coming up here is the Antichrist system. And the Antichrist comes out of it. Okay? A beast coming up out of the sea having 7 heads. And we've done a whole study on what they were, past, has been, and will be. And 10 horns. And on his horns, 10 crowns. And on his head, names of blasphemy. He continues in that chapter, verse 4 in your notes. And they worshiped, people on the earth, the dragon who gave authority to the beast. So the dragon who is Satan, who is the devil. What are they? Who? What does he do? He gives his authority to the Antichrist, to the beast. Why is he called a beast? Because anything not 100% human is a beast.
Come on.
And the Antichrist will be a Nephilim. He will be the son of Satan, just like we see in Genesis chapter 6. But he will also have a half-human DNA in him. Therefore, he will have a spiritual authority in the earth. Because Satan has to work through Adam, has to work through, because we have spiritual authority in the earth, okay? So the dragon gives the authority to the beast, and they worship the beast, saying, who is like the beast? Who is able to fight with him? Why are they saying that? Because he's going to come in and he's going to stop a bunch of nasty chaos going on in this world. What if a man right now rose up on the scene and put down the whole ISIS situation and brought peace to the global world government thing, solved the whole thing, and gave free energy to everybody, zero gravity energy, zero point energy, all the stuff they're always talking about. And like, you know, all this wonderful stuff happened. And the only thing is, you know, things were going great, but then he just stands up one day and says, well, I just need to tell you that I'm God, and you just need to worship me. In people were saying, who can deal with him? Who can stand before him? Look, he put down all this stuff. You see, we think the Antichrist is going to be this roaring evil guy that's going to come on the scene. No. He's going to be peaceful. He's going to be the answer man. He's going to look right until he shows himself to be who he is. Chapter 16, verse 13. And I saw coming out of the mouth of the dragon. Who's the dragon? Satan, the devil. Out of his mouth, and out of the mouth of the beast. Who's the beast here? The Antichrist. And out of the mouth of who? The false prophet. Three unclean spirits that were as frogs. All right? A lot of reptilian stuff going on here.
Right.
Chapter 20, verse 2. And he, notice this, he sees the dragon, the serpent of old, again, Apostle Paul's reiterating this, who is the devil. Now, what does devil mean? Devil means the false accuser. Mark preached on that on Sabbath. He's always accusing God to us. He doesn't really want to heal you. Or you can't be healed. Look at the idiotic thing you did, and you think God's going to heal you? You're never going to be healed. Or look at so-and-so. They're looking at you crosswise today. They're thinking this about you. Or your pastor thinks this about you. Or this person down the street thinks, or your wife thinks this about you. Or your one of the first things Mark and I learned when we were married is when things and issues came up in our marriage where I would just think he was thinking something and he would think I was thinking something. And the only way to get to the bottom was to put it out on the table and say, are you really thinking this? And he's like, no, I'm not thinking that. And I'm like, wow, why was I thinking that? So many times we just keep this accusing voice. And in this area where the spirit of religion is rampant, the spirit of religion works with the accuser spirit, and then it's propelled by the spirit of witchcraft. And we don't have time to get into all that tonight. But you need to know the accusing spirit, that pharisaical, accusing, judgmental spirit is so prevalent in this area.
That's right.
And we need to learn that that is the devil, that accusing that accusing spirit, that he is the serpent of old, who is the devil, and who is Hasatan, who is Satan. What is Satan? That word there in the Greek means adversary. We have an opponent. And sometimes he's just waiting for us to wake up in the morning, just that, you know? We need to realize there were people who had adversarial conflicts just trying to get to the meeting tonight. Just trying to have your prayer time tonight. Just trying to press into the things of God. There is a force in this world preventing us, wanting to, from drawing close to God, from living with purpose. But greater is he that is in us than he who is in the world.
Come on.
But we need to know we have an adversary. And bound, he was going to be bound for 1,000 years. Now it's important in this verse, and I bounced off so much. Let me just read the whole verse again. And he seized the dragon, the serpent of old, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. Now, he in this verse is not God. Everybody say, not God.
Not God.
One of the premises that we've laid several lessons ago in this study is God is not fighting the devil. It's like a gnat having a war with an elephant. It is not going to happen. God never gets off his throne to fight the devil.
That's
right. The he here in this verse is a messenger, if you read the verse 1 of that chapter, that comes down from heaven. And this messenger seizes the dragon, all right?
Right.
And then I had to just throw this in because this is the end that we just read about in Isaiah 27, all right? When this serpent is finally killed. And the devil who led them astray was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur, where the beast, that's the Antichrist, and the false prophet are, and they shall be tortured day and night forever and ever. Everybody say, I don't feel sorry for the devil.
I don't feel sorry for the devil.
Okay? If you saw the evil, well, I just won't go there tonight, but these end time passages concerning the dragon creature clearly linked to Satan is important to view with other dragon passages in our Bibles. The Apostle John would have had a Hebrew, bless you, Middle Eastern understanding of this dragon from the Tanakh or the Old Testament, because that is where the Canaanite mythology, the Sumerian mythology, the Middle Eastern mythologies came from, where you have a warrior god that defeats the dragon and creates the earth. So look at that. And the last verse there, the new meditation, just to ponder on, is this same dragon is also mentioned in context with creation, the serpent of old. So it is important to understand that the dragon introduced at the beginning is also the dragon to be killed at the end. And so hopefully next week we'll pick up with letter M, part 2, and look at the judgment and rebellion of the dragon in connection with creation, the beginning.